course, is 1 hour, and we look forward to a pleasant interaction with you. What I'm going to do in the next 20 minutes is I'm going to talk about a very important scheme of the Government of India, which is called the Poshan Abhiyan. Now, this was launched on 8th of March, like Dr. Bhagwat brought out last year, and we celebrated the first anniversary yesterday. And I'm not going to talk about what this scheme is about, because, you know, typically any government scheme has a number of components, right? And everybody understands they have to be implemented, and they don't get implemented actually on ground, and therefore there are huge gaps which happen when a scheme is concerned. So what I'm going to talk about is as to how is this particular scheme different than what has happened till now, right? So what you see on the right is what we were probably doing for a number of years, right? We didn't know actually how to go about it. This Abhiyan has done is it has transformed a number of schemes to what you see on the left, right? So probably in this 1 year, we've understood as to what exactly is to be done if you're looking at malnutrition to be addressed in this country. And we all, I think, understand that it's not an easy task. It's a huge challenge which stands in front of our country. We keep talking about the demographic dividends which our country has, right? Everybody talks about, all politicians talk about it in their you know, speeches, and we keep talking about, but we are not talking about as to what is the average IQ level of people in India. And all doctors being here, I understand that you would know that we are probably in the bottom 50 countries in the world as far as the IQ levels go. And that primarily is impacted by, because what I showed you on the slide is because of undernutrition, malnutrition, right? So we may have the numbers, but probably we do not have the quality as far as the demography is concerned. So I think it's a huge challenge. It's a huge challenge. And if you look at, you know, an investment, from the investment or from the business point of view, a rupee turns into 34 rupees if it is rightly invested in nutrition towards the demographic dividend. It impacts the GDP to about 11%. That's a huge, huge figure, right? So it's not that you are investing money and it does not make business sense. It also makes a lot of business sense if we are able to achieve what we are striving for. Okay, just to give you an idea as to, you know, we keep talking about that India is a poor country, we don't have money and we need, you know, loans from World Bank to survive as far as the schemes are concerned. I'm just flashing 1 year's budget of various schemes in the country, right? And this is at the BE stage, that is for this particular financial year. You can look at the staggering figures which we are working on. We are looking at lakhs of crores across different schemes, starting from ICDS to PMVVY, to Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, to the adolescent girls, Poshan Abhiyan, 3,000 crores for 1 year. It's a 9,000 crore scheme over 3 years. You have the National Health Mission. Look at the figures, 30,000, right? Look at the figures for the Swasth Bharat Mission, rural and urban, 17,000. Right. So, and look at the bottom part. We have additional food subsidy. That question mark is actually rupee, I think, because of the font, it has become a question mark. It's actually the rupee symbol. Okay. Allocation of 1,69 crores. Right. That's the amount of money which is being pumped into when we look at the overall nutrition. So, I mean, you know, we should be feeling that, okay, in about 2 years or 3 years, I think we should be able to address what we were aiming at, right? So the issues primarily have been leakages, have been non-availability of service delivery, non-availability of interventions, the right people not getting the right intervention which was required to be there. And these are, by the way, budgets. These are not the expenditures. And if you unfortunately look at expenditures, the expenditures are not even 50%. Of what is being shown, which entails what? It entails that what was supposed to be delivered has actually not been delivered, right? So that's the challenge. That's the challenge in any scheme, right? So launching a scheme is the easiest. To be able to implement and then be able to sustain and then be able to reorganize that scheme as we move forward is important. So that is what exactly, you know, Poshan Abhiyan tries to do through various schemes which I just flashed. So these are the classical targets of any scheme. I am not getting into these details because, you know, our aim is not to achieve these targets. When we talk about in-house within the ministry, within the mission itself, we just don't focus on these targets. We are focusing on the service delivery, the interventions, the strengthenings which have been to be carried out as part of this Abhiyan. These will automatically fall into place. So we just don't look at these figures. There are a lot of other people who look at, who are looking at these figures. We have NFHS 4s and 5s and 6s which will come up, which I'm sure if this work gets carried forward for the next 2 or 3 years, these results will automatically be in place. Okay. So this is a pan-India scheme. It looks at covering all 36 states. It looks at all 719 districts. It has about 7,000 projects, that is your blocks, and 51,000 sectors, which is a classical terminology which is used in the Ministry of Women and Child Development, where the supervisor over the Anganwadi sits. So there are about 51,000 sectors across the country. We have 14 lakh field functionaries in terms of the Anganwadi workers, and we have a population of 10 crores to be addressed. And mind you, this is a rolling population, right? So 10 crores is the average figure which we get per year. Okay. So what has happened over the 1 year is what is flashed on this slide. What I want to highlight here is that we are on course. And since November, we have been scaling up this scheme. And I'll talk about the components of this scheme because I have to, unfortunately. But I'll talk about them in a different manner as to how they are making a difference overall. Right. So as of now, we are in the stage of scaling up. We are looking at development of an analytics platform. I think Dr. Sujit is going to talk about more about analytics, but I'll just touch upon it as to how are we integrating the analytics and the big data and the AI onto this platform which we have and the kind of data which we have been able to collect in the past 1 year. I'll be talking about that. Okay. Okay. Now, we call them the pillars of the Poshan Abhiyan. I am talking about only 4 of them. There are a number of other components. I will not touch upon them because I don't have the time for that. So we are talking about technology. We are talking about convergence, which Dr. Bhagwat just touched upon. I will go into detail as to how this is being achieved. And it's one of the most challenging aspects of this mission is convergence at all levels. Then, of course, we are looking at behavioral change communication, a very standard, you would say, part of any scheme of the Government of India. But what change has been brought in, I will talk about that. And of course, the capacity building, because till the time the Anganwadi worker gets empowered, the service delivery and the intervention, and not only the Anganwadi, the ASHA and the ANM as well, don't get empowered, the service delivery, the interventions are not going to be to the scale and to the order they are supposed to be. So that's a very, very important component of this mission. Okay. Coming on to the convergence part of it. Right. So now, this looks very good on the slide that, okay, we have something known as the National Council, at the Executive Council. That's a typical, you know, way Government of India works, any scheme in Government of India works. Make a few committees, start working, and the committees meet, issue out a few minutes, and that's thank you very much after that, right? Nothing moves on ground. So the difference lies here, where when we look at, the components of this mission. Though they look classically like any other this thing, but what happens is the technology is steering this. Now, if you look at the National Council is actually headed by the Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog. And he's one man who's been pushing this like, he's after our blood, if I may say so. I mean, he doesn't leave anybody, including the secretaries, including the joint secretaries, everybody, including the people in Niti Aayog. So it is being driven at his end and driven very, very strongly. For example, let's say the Executive Council was supposed to meet in 3 months. It has now been reduced to 45 days. We are meeting more frequently. Similarly, there are convergence platforms which are at the state, district, and project level, wherein people from all the schemes are getting together. So it's not only about the Ministry of Women and Child Development and the Ministry of Health. I will just flash a slide as to how many ministries are actually converging. And they are physically converging, because we have been part of the National Council and the Executive Council, where all the ministries, there are chief ministers who are attending these meetings, there are ministers of various ministries who are attending these meetings. There are a lot of drive into delivering on ground. The VHS in the day, which I'm not too sure how many are actually aware of. I just wanted to ask if you can just raise your hands, how many have actually heard about Poshan Abhiyan? Oh, wonderful, that's great. I'll request the organizers to next time kindly have our logo also on your backdrop. I find National Health Mission and Anemia Mukt Bharat will request for Poshan Abhiyan also to be there next time. Okay, I'm sure it is going to be. Okay, so this VHSND platform is one which is being driven now because it looks at health, it looks at sanitation, it looks at nutrition. Earlier it was VH day, then it became VHS day, and now it is VHSN day, right? And this is primarily being driven by all the three ministries. In fact, four ministries, even urban gets into the game once we look at urban areas. So this is being driven. The second platform which is being driven is the SHG platform, which has become very strong in the last 4 to 5 years. And I'll show you the figures which we have in terms of the self-help groups. So what is happening now is they are being trained, they are being capacity built to address issues of health as well as nutrition from their institution in Hyderabad. Okay. Coming on, you know, what's the backbone or the DNA we call of this Poshan Abhiyan, which is the technology. We call it the common application software. It's a mobile application. I'm quickly covering this because I think I'll be late with my time aspect. Okay. So it has primarily two mobile applications. One goes to the supervisor, the other goes to the Anganwadi. And this, when we started off as a pilot about 2 years back, we were not very sure whether, you know, the Anganwadis would be able to drive technology, right? And I am very happy to share with you today that we have more than 2 lakh Anganwadis who are using this mobile applications, right? And there are Anganwadis, you'll be surprised, who are 50, 60 years old, who've been very quick at adopting it. And why they have been quick, I'll tell you that. What has happened is that they were maintaining 11 registers, right? And these registers had multiple entries. The moment this mobile application has come in, their responsibilities are zero. They just punch in the data, the registers have gone. There are 9 states today which are not using the registers at all. Their data is available on the dashboard, the registers have just vanished, and they are more than happy doing it. So out of those 11 registers which they had, they have only one register left, which is for their stock taking of the take-home rations, which they have to do. Okay, the second, of course, is the supervisor's application, which looks at a sector, and it looks at their specific Anganwadi. So they get the data of their Anganwadi. It's a wonderful application. If you get time, kindly spend some time over this application, and I'll just briefly touch upon as to how it looks like, but I cannot cover the entire thing. Okay, there is a dashboard which is available on which, starting from the CDPO till the national level, we are able to see the entire data. So I can drill down and go to the last Anganwadi in this country and see as to what was delivered yesterday on that. It's real time, near real time. It gets updated every day in the night. We come to know as to how many Anganwadis are open or were not open a day prior. How many Anganwadis opened in 1 month? Were they open for 21 days or they were not open for 21 days? They are supposed to go to the Anganwadi, open the Anganwadi, click a picture of the children being fed and upload. That picture is available on the dashboard for the CDPO to see that, okay, the delivery has taken place. It is geotagged, so you cannot poodle fake. You go for a counseling session to a residence of a beneficiary, it is geotagged again. And mind you, this application works in online as well as offline. The entire data of the Anganwadi is available to her on the mobile, even if the connectivity is not there. And the data is available for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months with her as part of the mobile application. She can go back, she gets a lot of triggers as to what is to be delivered. Okay, sorry. Okay, so, okay, I have 5 minutes more. Great. So it looks at 8 modules which look at as to the various deliveries which are carried out in terms of the THRs, in terms of the feeding, in terms of counseling, in terms of immunization, whatever is there in your MCP card is being captured on the mobile application. Okay, I'm skipping this in terms of what is the workflow which is followed. Okay, I'll just quickly tell you as to what are the figures today. So we are looking at 2,10,000 Anganwadis. We are looking at 14 states already adopted, 113 districts where this software is already working. The figures in terms of the beneficiaries, almost 3 crore registered household which are available across the country on this mobile application. And the figures in terms of children and the beneficiaries is what is flashed. Okay. Now, there is an automatic system of sending out SMSs to the beneficiaries as well as to the Anganwadis, the CTPOs, and the supervisors in case the delivery is not taking place. A simple thing like if on month to month a child's weight does not increase, that SMS goes out to the beneficiary as well as to the Anganwadi that the child's weight has not increased. So the figures of the SMSs which have gone out is what is flashed. Okay, next is, I'll just quickly come on to what's changed in the SBCC. The SBCC is now a multi-sectorial activity. It is no more restricted to each ministry. All ministries have come together. There are 13 ministries as on date which are converging under the banner of Poshan Abhiyan. Right, and there was a guideline which was issued as to how we will take the SBCC forward, which was a combined guideline of all these 13 ministries. And it is now being driven by all these 13 ministries plus the partnerships. When I'm talking about partnerships, like Dr. Bhagwat mentioned, we have the National Nutrition Resource Center, which is funded by the Tata Trust. Similarly, we have the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which is looking after the mobile application. So these are the number, the UNICEF looks after the SBCC in specific across all ministries. So this is how the convergence is taking place, not only within the ministries, but as well as with the partners who are supporting this. Okay. These are the 12 ministries which I was talking about. We've added agriculture to it lately, and we are going to have an agri-nutrition conference, which is going to look at specifically the agriculture component as part of Poshan Abhiyan on the 15th, that is next week. Now, these are the platforms which I was talking about. We already talked about them. And the aligning of the frontline functionaries. We are looking at the Anganwadi workers. We are looking at the ASHAs and the ANM, which count to about 24 lakhs. We are looking at the SAGs, which are 47 lakh in numbers, and 5 crore women are a part of this. This is a huge platform which is now being used for nutrition. And the Swachagrahis, of course, this program is getting over now, that 4 lakh Swachagrahis, which were there as part of the Swachhata Abhiyan. Okay, now just to give you a picture as to how does Jan Andolan actually translate on ground. So we have a specific dashboard for the activities which are carried out on ground, and we had a Poshan Maah in the month of September where all these ministries came together and we carried out activities. So we were able to touch 25.4 crore people across this country. And yesterday there has been a launch of a Poshan Pakwada which is going to be there for 15 days. Now, and I'll just show you as to what we captured yesterday night. Okay, I'm just skipping this slide because I don't have the time. Okay, so this is what was launched yesterday. And if you look at the participation, it's already touched almost 23 lakhs by yesterday night. The entries which we received at about 11 o'clock in the night. So this is the kind of mobilization which is taking place across the country with ministries, with everybody in place. Right. So unfortunately, I'm out of time. Therefore, I'm going to stop here. And if you have any question, I'll be more than willing to answer during the question answer session. Thank you so much.
Next speaker, after this discourse by Mr. Samir Kanwar, is Dr. Sujit Ranjan. Dr. Kanwar, Mrs. Kanwar spoke about the National Nutritional Resource Center, Government of India, and how this Poshan Abhiyan is being rolled out in India. Now, he will give us some few tips regarding the Coalition for Food and Nutrition Security. So it's an interesting topic. Let's look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Respected Dr. Kapoor, Professor Bharatwaj, Mr. Rajesh Sharma, and my fellow panelists, and ladies and gentlemen. First of all, it's a great opportunity for me, and I'm feeling very great to be here talking about the Poshan. And I was very happy to see the hands, like the raising hands of so many people, those who are aware about the Poshan Abhiyan. I think it's a great opportunity for us how the Poshan is going in a mission mode, and that's the Abhiyan. The first time in the 2005, we heard about the NRHM, National Rural Health Mission. Then in the year 2009, this education mission, and now in 2018, this Poshan Abhiyan. So now the nutrition is the national agenda. It's going in the mission mode. And that's why Now, lots of things we are discussing, how to take it forward, it's a national agenda. And so far as the coalition, I'm representing the Coalition for Food and Nutrition Security, is one of the partner of Poshan Abhiyan and the partner of the Tata Trust, the Indian Nutrition Initiative. And the Coalition for Food and Nutrition Security is an organization launched by Professor M.S. Swaminathan in the year 2007. And the purpose was how the nutrition will be the big agenda among all the policy leaders, among the program leaders, and people will talk about the nutrition. And for that purpose, Professor M.S. Swaminathan, the father of Green Revolution of India, started this coalition. And at present, there are 120 members of this coalition, and 120 members are coming from government, non-governmental organization, from academia, from the medical sector, health sector, from the donor sector, from the implementing organization, research organization. So this is a group of policy leaders and the program leaders. And the 120 members, we have divided like all 120 members into eight subgroups. So subgroups means they are developing policy papers, position papers for the Poshan Abhiyan, how the agenda will take it forward in a very effective manner. Like for example, one of the group is essential nutrition intervention, then the food security. See, wash and nutrition, how that can be integrated. Because under this Poshan Abhiyan, we are not taking only the intermediate cause of nutrition. It's not only the intermediate cause, that is the lack of food availability and the disease. We are taking the underlying causes, at the same time, the root causes. Underlying causes, that means the access to the health services. Underlying causes, that's the inadequate food security. Underlying causes, that the environmental, sanitation, water, and at the same time, the root cause, that's the structure, the leadership, the gender, status of women in the society. So all those things are part of this Poshan Abhiyan. And the coalition is helping through the position paper, through the our research and the data application, how we can ensure the good policy as well as the good governance. That's the role of coalition is playing for this Poshan Abhiyan. And when I am saying the good governance, how the good governance can ensure the commitment, accountability, and that will followed by the good effective implementation, effective policy, followed by the monitoring, the how the monitoring is taking place, how the data is being analyzed, data is going down the line, the quality of data, the validation of the data, and data is going to share among all the stakeholders. And we know this fact very well, that the data can bring definitely the commitment, data can ensure the accountability, the hold the people accountable, and at the same time the data can bring the responsiveness for the nutrition outcomes. So for that purpose, coalition is with the help of the 120 leading organizations, individuals, we are working in this field. I'm just sharing one experience when we are working with this teenie in Rajasthan. Like the data was, and we know this fact very well, this Poshan Abhiyan in the year, last year, in the year 2018, 8th March started. After that, we decided to work in Rajasthan, especially in five most, poor, where the indicators, health and nutrition indicators were poor, we worked there. And how to, the data was there. The National Family Health Survey, the data was available with the government. The data was available with the service providers. Data was available with other stakeholders. But how to present the data in a very different manner. At the same time, how to go for the some primary data like the knowledge, attitude, practice, and the purpose was how quality service delivery can generate the demand. So that was the role we played there. And I'm happy to share, like in Poshan Abhiyan, like I'm in this public health sector for last 20 years. Whatever we people were suggesting or recommending to the government, under Poshan Abhiyan, most of the things have been captured. Most of the things are part of now Poshan Abhiyan. But the most important thing, the decision-making process. The most important thing is the asking right questions. The most important thing is like the differential planning. It's not the plan for the entire state, entire district, rather how the differential plan can be made at district level, block level, for the better nutrition outcomes. See, I'm just sharing one, how we usually present the data. So this is the data of National Family Health Survey, and the data was presented like this. So what we did, like assessing burden by color coding, how we can generate the competition among the districts, how we can generate the kind of aspiration that, yes, I have to do something. My district is going in red, high zone district. How that will go to the green zone, and what kind of efforts have to be made. So this, by this way, this color coding was not, this is the state level, but at the same time, the block data was made like this. The village data, like panchayat data, was prepared like this. Then the mapping. It's not like the entire state, we can say the stunting is an issue. Entire state, the wasting, entire state is the undernutrition. No. Which are the pockets where the state can play an important role, whether the other stakeholders can play an important role. And the Poshan Abhiyan, the most important is not only the reduction in stunting, wasting, undernutrition, rather Poshan Abhiyan is also talking about the better monitoring, talking about the bringing the issues, alerting the issues for right decision, quick decision, and at the same time guiding, directing the other line management, the other line, like the other players in the line management. So this helped a lot. Like a state can focus the resources, the human resources, the financial resources, the technical resources, where that will go and how that will make a difference. This is again an effective way of understanding the gaps. You know, like I'm just quoting an example of Alwar district of Rajasthan. So what we did, the same data, same National Family Health Survey data, we know this fact that malnutrition being a multi-dimensional, multi-sectoral problem. So we tried to analyze in a very different manner with various indicators, and the radar diagram was used for that. So radar is one of the best way, visualization tool that was used for the NFHS data of a district. And here you can easily understand, like the entire district, the child feeding practices is the key issue. At the same time, you can see the child immunization, vitamin A supplementation found key issues. Then the antenatal care, postnatal care found the key issues. So immediately, we are very much sure that where we have to hit, which are the key targets, how the plan can be prepared, how the responsibility can be fixed, and accountability can be there among the service providers. Now again, this is the second example in Assam. So Assam, we again gathered the same kind of information from the three districts. Like, there are 33 districts in Assam, Northeast, and Northeast, again, the maternal mortality was very, very high. You know this fact. very well. So how to take it forward? How the system can understand where they have to put the resources and the put the plan in a different manner? So among, though there are 33 districts, but we collected data from all the three districts and also the subgroups, like the which are the districts are similar. Maybe four districts, most of the problems are similar to the same. And some of the other districts, the problem are very, very different. So for getting the data, for bringing the data from the field, we decided to go for some rapid assessment. At the same time, some social audit. We organized social audit in all the districts for getting the data, like the people's perception, how they are thinking about the services, what kind of understanding they are having, which services are going on well, whether the Anganwadi or the from the health mission, the sub-center, how the sub-center is working, the service provider, Asha, Anganwadi worker, and the ANM, what kind of coordination. So by this way, we try to gather all kinds of information, and the state decided that no, we have to go for the multi-sectoral approach. The issues, the water is very, very high. The issues is with regard to the wash is very serious. There are 83% at the time of the birth, 83% normal, like the weight at the time of birth. But after 6 months, the malnutrition is going high and high in Assam. It's because of the IOSCF is a serious issue. So that was decided. Like again, in one district, I'm taking this radar diagram for Barpeta. Easily we understood like mothers who had full antenatal is very low here. So one can easily understand that we have to put efforts like the monitoring, supervision, supportive supervision, the data will come on a monthly, weekly basis. So by this way, this was presented. Then again, the three districts, I was talking about the Barpeta, Udalguri, then Golpara. We collected data and we prepared a plan based, this is the differential plan for these three districts. Similarly, the other districts. So the plan is more or less same. Sir, sure. So this by this way, this Assam decided to go for the strong. So I'm just talking about the outcomes. So when we presented for last 8-9 months, the efforts is going on, and you can see like now the state government, the other stakeholders, they decided to go for a kind of nutrition working group. How the technical support will come from the working group. They decided to go for the policy seminar, bringing people from the different other parts of the country to learn about the success, about the good implementation in their states. Then also the enabling environment at village level, how the construction of the building, the coordination, the training, capacity building of the service providers, and the setting the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goal, at the district level, so that the data can come through the SDG cell. And so this is the learning we are having under the Poshan Abhiyan across the country, but I just shared the learning from the two states. And the data, if you are not going for that under this Poshan Abhiyan, definitely there is no, we will not understand the capacity, we will not understand the structure, we will not understand the convergence forum, we will not understand the leadership issues, and by this way, we are making a change. So now the next step is, though the data is there, but now we are trying to bring the data from the district, from the field, like the block data. We are going to modify and the priorities, how that can be changed of the district and state, then they improve the intervention and reach to the identified pockets. It's not the entire, like that panchayat, that particular cluster, and how to go for the quick wins, and ultimately to promote the accountability. So this learning is going on, and I'm happy to share the learning of this coalition for food and nutrition security in Poshan Abhiyan. And thanks to the organizer for giving us this opportunity to present this learning here. Thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Ranjan, I have a small question.
Yes, sir, please.
You just spoke about the fact that we need to concentrate more on those areas where we are having the problem of undernutrition, some wasting or stunting. Now, you see the ICDS project as it is being presently implemented by the government. So what we do is normally from every block we send proposals that this much is the fund requirement for this particular period. And thereafter, it is implemented in all the areas.
Correct.
So I was just wondering that how we are going to select areas and how, say, within the state, because I'm working in WCD. So within the state of HP, if we find that there are certain pockets only, how do we focus specifically on those when we have to give special projects with respect to each area on the basis of norms devised by Government of India? This one, please.
I think this is a very valid question you have raised, and we also face this problem, like the how a state, though the state is preparing a plan for the entire districts, all the districts are coming, how the differential planning will take place. So here, you know, like based on the correct data from the district, from the block, if you are having that data clear, if you are understanding that, no, I don't need that kind of supply issues in that particular district. That kind of, we don't want, like the THR is not taking place because of the geography issue, because of the Anganwadi workers are not in place or the lady supervisors are not there. How the plan will be different, like to fill the positions first, like some kind of mobility support, some kind of coordination, special efforts will go for the coordination among the our frontline workers. That can be planned. Similarly, there are few districts where the wash intervention is very, very poor, like arsenic, fluoride issues are very high. How we can go for that kind of coordination and in a time-bound manner, like in 6 months, the awareness generation, maybe the check of the, go for the verification of all the hand pumps, like other, the tap water facilities, how that can be ensured. Similarly, the sanitation part, the open defecation, in which districts, in which block, that kind of open defecation is very, very high, how that is hampering the quality nutrition. So by this way, if you are not having the micro data, sir, it's very difficult to go for the differential planning. So we tried to gather from the field.
Dr. Ranjan, we have question and answer session later on. I think we have one more speaker still left. So yeah, thank you, so, Dr. Ranjan.
Even as Utkarsh is marching ahead, please, Utkarsh. I introduced him very briefly, but I'll take a minute more, Utkarsh. See, this whole Poshan Abhiyan, when it was launched, the Government of India had an earlier model of Swachh Bharat Prerakas working at the district level, young professionals who are contributing to the whole Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. And so on a similar model, they approached us and said, you know, can we have Swasth Bharat Prerakas? So a team of 300 plus young professionals like Utkarsh are posted across the districts and will be reaching up to 700 plus now very shortly. They're actually making a big difference. Colonel Samir will agree with that. There's a lot of positive things. And of course, Mr. Rajesh Sharma is sitting in Himachal Pradesh. He can add his own views. But I also invite the youngsters amongst you. We are opening up more positions, more across districts. If any one of you who's interested in spending a year on really contributing to the nutrition situation in India, you're more than willing to, you know, we'll be welcoming you. And, you know, you'll be welcomed like anything, you'll be supported, and you'll really get a fantastic experience across India for grassroots thing. How do you handle the situation? Over to you, Utkarsh. Please share what you have been doing.
Yeah. So, good morning to everyone. First of all, I am deeply honored and humbled to speak in front of such esteemed panelists and obviously such intellectual audience we have here. So Dr. Isha has just given a brief about actually how, what we are doing at the field level. And so Swasth Bharat Prerakas is one of its largest in India. And currently we are accelerating the progress of Poshan Abhiyan. So our organization, TINIT, our trust, has joined hands with the ministry.
Just one second, your presentation is not there. Can we have the presentation, please?
Yeah. Yeah. So our organization, Dini Tata Trust, has joined hands with the Ministry of Women and Child Development to place each one of us in the high burden districts across India. Currently, we are 300 in numbers, and we would be scaling up to 720 all over India. And as our mandate, what we are doing basically is we are monitoring, we are analyzing, we are looking at how the program has to be effectively implemented in the district and the state overall. And how can we analyze the gaps? We can fill the gaps. We can strategize. We can iterate our plans accordingly, restructure the things to whatever the resources we have. We are pushing for that in each of our districts. So we are currently working in three districts of Himachal Pradesh. We all pray Riks. I'm working in Shimla. We have Tushar here from Solan. And then in Hamirpur, we have Khushbu. And all three together as a team are working to drive the Poshan Abhiyan forward. We are coordinating at district level, at project level, at state level to discuss the strategies of what initiatives we have taken and how can we, you know, we are doing pilots and how can we scale it them on a large under Poshan Abhiyan. So I would just quickly go through over the, you know, apart from many initiatives that we have taken in the state. So these are the few, actually, that's the snaps of what we are doing in each district. So I would like to discuss one of our SBPs in Hamirpur is doing a tremendous work in the menstrual hygiene management part. She was basically facilitating the survey in collaboration with the NGO named Himalayan Mahila Evam Jan Kanyan Kalyan Sanstha under the leadership and guidance of DC Hamirpur. And the survey has been just conducted recently in February 2019 to understand the perception of different aspects of menstrual hygiene among adolescent girls and women. And the survey has been very successful. In fact, yesterday only it was appreciated by our Honorable Chief Minister of the state. Further, the action plan for that district is to generate awareness among women of all age groups regarding promoting hygiene and safe disposal practice at the panchayat level. The plan is also to install incinerators for the safe disposal of the sanitary napkins. The pilot for this has already been started. In schools as well, electric incinerators will be installed for the safe disposal of the sanitary napkins. So the SBP Hamirpur is doing a pretty tremendous job in this. Secondly, Tushar is here. I would like to highlight one such instance where he has, you know, made a difference. So Surya Vihar is a very densely populated area in Solan urban district sector. Now, what he has done on one such prereqs, actually we prereqs do monitoring visits to the Anganwadi centers on a monthly basis, on a very regular basis, to actually just inspect what is going on or what is lacking, either the convergence, either the things are being delivered at the Anganwadi center level, if we are talking about Anganwadi center as a fulcrum point of all the things. So in one such visit, our prerak Tushar has just located this slum population nearby an Anganwadi center, and he was able to successfully register all that migratory population in the Anganwadi center, which in turn provided you know, all the services that were available in the Anganwadi centers to the beneficiaries. And there was a handsome amount of beneficiaries in that slum community. As of today, CB's activities are conducted, Godbharai, just to you know, generate awareness. Annaprashan and birthday celebration goes on at consistent pace. As far as I am concerned, I'm working in Shimla, and I recently collaborated with the Cultural Passage team organization to drive volunteer contributions and interactions with the frontline functionaries in the Anganwadi center. So that Cultural Passage organization is working towards achieving sustainable development goals of United Nations. So through their collaboration, I'm trying to effectively deliver the right message and counseling to all our beneficiaries in the Anganwadi centers. Secondly, Sir. Okay, sir. Sorry. Yes, sir. Just quickly. So the convergence, I have played a major instrumental part in the convergence. The implementation, by implementing the plan, we have gathered useful insights and the regarding the data validation and authenticity. And we are now currently iterating the plan so to make it more robust and in terms of data collection and validation. So these are all the basic challenges that I've generally talked about. And the way ahead, just the last slide. So where I look at where the problem exactly is the ground level convergence which we require, where the ASHA and the Anganwadi worker coordinate well to effectively implement all the services in the Anganwadi center. So that was the part. Thank you. So that's it. So.
Thank you. Now the session is open for questions. Any questions, please direct to the speaker and you can.
Yeah, this has been a really very interesting discussion. Would like to add a few topics, especially in view of the fact that all of the speakers, they have laid emphasis on one fact, that is convergence at all levels. That reminds me of one of the instances which I recently faced during my stint as Director WCD. We were just opening the tenders for various pulses and dalia, et cetera, which is to be supplied to all the Anganwadi workers for further, for providing it further to the children, to the lactating mothers, or say in whatever, say, as per the instructions and guidelines of the government. So what happened was that we, as a state, we have to go to the Civil Supplies Corporation because the tendering process is quite long and you can't store all these eatables for quite long. It is, say, maximum 2-3 months that you have to store all these articles at the field level. So one of the Anganwadi workers during my tour to Chamba district, she raised a problem that, sir, we are getting this ration slightly late, so please try to expedite the delivery so that we can provide it in time to all the eligible people. So that suggestion kept hovering on mind. So I also asked our civil supplies people that, yeah, please try to expedite it. So they came with the 3-4 arguments. First, related to this provision of fortified edible oil. Now, fortified edible oil is not mostly available in our country. Rather, it is available only in a few pockets. I think some manufacturer from Orissa is only supplying it, not others are supplying it. So,
correction, sir, it is actually widely available now.
Yeah.
A lot of brands are actually.
I'll definitely get into this. But yeah, I was just trying to say, what are the problems which we are facing at the ground level? So, this is one area. So, I just asked them, the civil supplies people, that now, as per the FSSAI Act, it has been made mandatory that whenever we are supplying all these articles, whether it is salt, whether it is edible oil, it has to be fortified. Then why you are not purchasing only fortified edible oil and fortified salt? So then they came out with another round of problems. Okay, that was gone. So then we went to the IPS department. Why? Drinking water is still a problem in some of the areas. So their issue was that, yeah, some of our groundwater resources, they are not working fine. So this is one area where we need to address immediately. So these two examples led me to think that, yeah, we need to get together quite often. Kanav Samir, he spoke about this convergence part, that we are meeting more often, maybe once in 45 days or once in 15 days. But I think that needs to be stretched to around 15 days. Every fortnight we have to meet. We had 2-3 video conferencing together with Government of India representatives. So there also certain issues of similar nature emerged, that different departments are working in silos, so we need to get together to solve these problems. Otherwise, IFA tablet, it is being administered for the last more than 30 years. Anganwadi workers, they are distributing take-home ration for the last more than 10 years. So health education department that is going on with this routine of midday meal for the last one. So we need to work together. So that is the main point. There, that's what we need to understand. And there, I think that is the best part of this program, that government has put emphasis on it, and there is a full scale, there is an institutional kind of setup where we have to ensure that this meeting takes place. So this is one of the takes. And in case you have any query, any question, please, you are welcome.
Yes. Yes. Question.
Yeah, I wanted to ask whether this dashboard data and the IT platform information is available, open access, or is it closed only for providers?
No, it is as of now it is closed, because we have beneficiary level data available on that, so it cannot be made public. But we will have a dashboard which is coming up, which is only looking at the analytics part of it, probably in another 6 months, wherein you would be able to see the generic data in terms of the districts and the block level data. But the Jan Andolan dashboard, which I showed you, is open. It's an open platform, but it doesn't have beneficiary data.
Why can't be given for medical colleges for research purposes or for service providers helping?
I just told you that it has beneficiary level data. So we cannot start sharing names of beneficiaries in the open forum, right? Okay. It has the Aadhaar data of the beneficiaries. So all that cannot, the mobile number of the beneficiary, it cannot be shared in public. That's the issue. To come over that issue, what you are saying, we already acknowledge that issue, and we have a dashboard which is coming up, which will look at the analytics part of it. So that data will be available to you analyzed in the analyzed form.
Thank you.
I am Dr. Karmakar from the Institute of Hygiene and Public Health. I apologize if my query is addressed in earlier session, but my query is regarding this action plan for control of open field defecation in Himachal Pradesh or in hilly areas, particularly for those villages which are situated near the streams, Joras, and these canals with tributaries of the river.
I think we should be asking questions pertaining to the session which has been held just now, and this particular thing really doesn't belong to this session.
Thank you.
Sir, I was working in Bihar for some time. I'm from South. The difference I found in Bihar is portion, THR, take home ration, is closely linked with our immunization program. They are bringing children for vaccination once in a month, the same day when THR is distributed. If that is not supplied continuously for 3 months, then our immunization coverage also goes down. So it is both these are interlinked there. In South, this ration distribution and immunization programs are not that much linked. Just sharing what I observed.
Good. I think this is a very good observation, and I was also in Bihar. But now the government of Bihar has taken a decision, like THR, the take-home ration will take place, that is once in a month, but the immunization will not be linked with that. So that's the latest development in Bihar. So THR will take place 15th of second Tuesday of every month, whereas the immunization, as per the like ANM's macro plan, that is taking place. So it's not linked together, because the other health and nutrition services are not taking place on the same day. That's why government of Bihar has taken a decision.
I have a question to Kanasamy, sir. There's an Anganwadi app which has been prepared and being in use. I just wanted to know how far and what was the methodology to acquaint these Anganwadi workers to use this app very nicely.
It's a very good question, because even we were very apprehensive when we were actually piloting it, testing it out about 2 years back. Now, there is a whole lot of effort which goes into, hand-holding the Anganwadis in terms of training, which is carried out through an organization known as CARE. So they have their teams, and it's a cycle of almost about 2+ months in which each module is taught to them. They go on ground, they are handheld, they enter the data, come back, we look at the quality of data, then they go back again with the second module. There are 8 modules in the mobile application, and 8 training sessions are separately carried out for them. And the adoption of technology has been phenomenal. I have another presentation, but of course we don't have the time. I could have shown you as to what is the kind of adoption of technology at the Anganwadi level. And we are looking at Anganwadis which are 60 plus of age as well, 50 to 60. And the adoption has been phenomenal. It is very encouraging for us as well.
Sir,
okay.
One second. Vitamin A is not under supply, not supplied from September.
I'm really interested to know, because one radar gram was showing regarding the big gap is utilization of the services or the kind of the practices at the village level. So the big the problem in the nutrition we have observed in the Madhya Pradesh, what I have seen, it is kind of like how to make them to use their own nutritious food at their own level, and in the term of community based nutrition rehabilitation, have you ever thought of, and is there any kind of the scope under this Poshan program?
I think Utkarsh would like to add, but I'll just mention one issue in this, that there is a component in the Poshan Abhiyan which is known as innovations, which looks at this particular aspect. And like I told you, that we are already initiating a dialogue with the Agriculture Ministry, and we have a conference now, a full day session where we are looking at the academic people coming in and the agricultural institutes coming in to look at these very specific issues which are available on ground. Utkarsh, you can add more.
So to add to this part, actually, we are actually promoting the state's local recipes through the events we are currently organizing, through community-based events or like Poshan Pakhwada yesterday we started. So at these are the actually the points where we are promoting the local recipes of the state, and we are making people aware about these nutritional recipes. And apart from that, whatever the monthly based events we are conducting, like VHSNDs or through CBEs, we are involving the local recipe part. That is also one of our major, innovative, way of promoting the recipes in the state. So we are doing that. We are doing that. We are promoting the local recipes.
Thank you.
Just last question. Can I please ask?
Because the next session has to start. The speakers are already here. So I thank all the speakers.
We are here, ma'am.
Can I? This is just a 30-second question to Colonel Sandeep. I've just walked in and I heard you saying that the data set, whatever data set you're talking about, has beneficiary information, or if I may say so, it's a patient identifiable or a person identifiable information. I was just wondering that if you're keeping a data set closed, can't you provide a unique identifier hiding those beneficiary information and then make it available publicly to the academic institutes or providers? Otherwise, what's the use of keeping closed data sets?
I think I've already answered that question, that there is a dashboard which is coming up which will be available to the public in terms of the analyzed data sets. So those would be available for the public review. And as far as the data sets are concerned, they are available when you look at the NFHS 4 or the NFHS 5 which is going to come. So those are surveys which are available in public for whatever kind of academic studies which you want to carry out. And else the data is available at the state level, and therefore if the state wishes to engage with any of such institutions, they are most welcome to engage, share the data without the beneficiary details, and take it forward from there.
Okay. Now I will thank all the audience and the speakers for patiently listening and speaking about this thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. I request the speakers and the members of the panel to kindly stay on the stage for felicitations. I request Dr. Janaki from Sri Lanka to kindly come over the stage, ma'am, to kindly felicitate Sri Rajesh Sharma. May I now request Dr. Suryodaya Tripathi from Thailand to kindly come off the stage, sir, to felicitate Dr. Suresh Kapoor. I request Dr. Mansoor Ahmed from Bangladesh to kindly come over the stage, sir, to kindly felicitate Dr. Praveen Bhardwaj. I request Shri Rajesh Sharma to kindly felicitate Dr. Bhagwat. I request Dr. Suresh Kapoor to kindly felicitate Colonel Samir Kanwar. I request Dr. Praveen Bhardwaj to kindly felicitate Dr. Sujit Ranjan. I request Dr. Anmol Gupta to kindly felicitate Utkarsh Sharma.
Thank you. बोल दे पहले तो ये चीज़ देखा बट अब आयोजन कहाँ गया वो